This is Perspectivas Latinas, a community service of CAN-TV. I'm Juan Carlos Hernandez. Our guest today is Vanessa Uribe from the National Council of La Raza. She is here to talk about the organization's work in our city and their efforts across the country. Welcome.
Hi, thank you for having me.
Well, thanks for coming out. I know I've been trying for a while to get you guys to come in, and I'm really glad you're here. Let's start off by talking about you and what brought you to NCLR and what you do there.
Great. So I am a product of Chicago's Little Village community on the southwest side of the city. I have firsthand experienced some of the challenges of being a young Latina in a low-income community and an immigrant community. And so early on, I knew that I wanted to do something where I gave back, where I tried to help people like me and my family, my neighbors, you know, to have better access to resources and opportunities. And so I was lucky enough to join NCLR about 6 years ago almost.
Six years?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So I feel privileged to be a part of such a great organization. Mm-hmm. The National Council of La Raza is a large civil rights and advocacy organization. And so given that I've had, you know, I've struggled as a child and I've been able to take advantage of some resources and opportunities, I feel lucky to be a part of organizations that try to do the same thing for communities of need.
Okay, and what is your role at the National Council of La Raza?
So at NCLR, mm-hmm. I am the Senior Midwest Regional Coordinator. Mm-hmm. My role really focuses on establishing and cultivating relationships with nonprofit organizations in the Midwest region. Mm-hmm. NCLR is a national organization, and we're based in Washington, D.C., but we have offices across the country, and our affiliates, which are community-based organizations, almost 300 of them that are located across the country, are divided into regions. And so in the Midwest region, I focus on serving as a liaison of sorts between our Washington, D.C. headquarters and our affiliates here in the Midwest region, which mm-hmm. Includes 9 states. And we have 59 organizations here.
59 in 9 states?
Yes.
Wow, that's a lot. And, well, you are a national organization. I certainly want to talk about what you do in the Midwest and specifically in Chicago. But you said the National Council of La Raza, NCLR, as you're, more, I think, more widely known, is a civil rights organization. What do you do in that area of work on a national basis?
Sure. So NCLR works in a variety of different areas, mm-hmm. but we focus primarily through 2 avenues. One is policy and advocacy, mm-hmm. And the other is in building the capacity of our affiliate network of community-based organizations. We work in the areas of health, education, housing, jobs and financial security, civil rights and immigration. And really, our goal is to inform policymakers and the general public of the needs of the Hispanic community. Mm-hmm. While at the same time helping to build the capacity of these organizations and creating opportunities for the adoption of policies and programs that equitably serve the Latino community.
Okay, and you mentioned advocacy, because I think that could sometimes be a fine line. We were talking about that before the show had for some of these nonprofits, because they can't necessarily go out and, they can't try to influence policy, but they certainly can advocate for issues, right?
Right, mm-hmm. right. So so there's a fine line between what we call lobbying mm-hmm. and advocacy. And okay. So NCLR works with our partners, specifically Alliance for Justice, and mm-hmm. we conduct trainings for our affiliate organizations who have 501c3 status, mm-hmm. which means the nonprofit status.
Right.
And if they cross that line sometimes between lobbying and advocacy, they're risking their status as a nonprofit organization. Mm-hmm. So we want to be careful about that, and we want to make sure that we educate our organization so that they're aware of advocating versus lobbying, and mm-hmm. Making sure that they're overall educated on the issues and that they're meeting with their representatives on those issues specifically.
And how does that training help? How does it work? And what have some of these organizations told you about how it's helped them in this area of work?
Yeah, well, I think, you know, for many of our organizations, mm-hmm. Resources are limited. They mm-hmm. want to help the community, and they're doing mm-hmm. a lot for the community. And oftentimes there isn't any kind of training or resources to kind of focus on whether or not they can advocate or mm-hmm. whether they can do advocacy.
Right.
And so NCLR, we put together an event every March in Washington, D.C., where we help to train them on what advocacy is and how to do it. So how mm-hmm. do they meet with their representatives? What are the things that they bring up? And then on the second day after the training, we meet with our representatives. So we have folks coming in from all over the country, and they're able to set up meetings and meet with their representatives in Washington, D.C. So it's really great for us to help provide them with that information.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time, we're building the capacity and the strength of the organizations at the ground mm-hmm. level to advocate on the issues.
Okay, and so the representatives just, they walk in and into these offices of these representatives and they just discuss, like, this is what our communities are facing, and we would like you to pay attention to that. Essentially, is that how advocacy works?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they are educated on the issues. Mm-hmm. They oftentimes, you know, there needs to be education also to the representatives. And so sharing their story, sharing their personal story, mm-hmm. sharing why this issue affects them and why they want or they encourage the representative to take notice and hopefully to act on behalf of their constituents.
Mm-hmm.
So it's more of an educational tool.
Okay.
But they're advocating on behalf of the community in need.
Wow, that's awesome. And I'm sure that a lot of these nonprofits, like you said, I think are grateful because you're helping them use their resources more effectively.
Yeah. Yes.
And now, well, let's localize your work. You say that you're divided into how many regions?
We have six regions. Yes, six regions. Mm-hmm. So we have offices in Miami, San Antonio, Phoenix, Los Angeles, New York City, and Chicago. And those are our six regions. So
okay.
we have a regional office there. And actually, the Midwest is one of the largest regions across the country. We have 59 community-based organizations, as I mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really great. And we actually have 19 here in Chicago,
19.
Which is our largest concentration of affiliates in the Midwest.
Okay, mm-hmm. and how does, well, let's talk about that. How does someone become, or an organization become an affiliate of NCLR?
Yeah, so organizations that, one, align with the issue areas of NCLR, so the ones that I mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
If they align with our issue areas and they're Latino serving, so they have to meet a criteria of Latino serving organizations.
Mm-hmm.
That includes the population they serve, their leadership, their board.
Mm-hmm.
And they're welcome to reach out to us. We have information about some of the requirements and the benefits of affiliation. But you know, we do encourage organizations that are interested in becoming an affiliate to reach out to us, and we're happy to follow up.
Okay, and so there's a process, an application process?
Yes, there's an application process.
Mm-hmm.
We welcome new affiliates twice a year, it's approved by our board of directors. So it is a process. You know, we take pride in our affiliate network and the mm-hmm. organizations that are part of our organization. And so we want to make sure that there's alignment and that we can help to
right.
provide the same resources, you know, to them.
Mm-hmm. And once you're an affiliate, that makes you eligible for these trainings, going to D.C. And what else does NCL provide for these affiliates?
Yes. So really, our affiliates are the backbone of what NCLR
mm-hmm.
does. You know, the work that we're doing is on behalf of our affiliates and really the Latino community. Once organizations are part of the affiliate network, NCLR helps to provide trainings. We do everything from building the internal capacity of the organization so that they are better prepared to pursue funding opportunities, develop their board,
mm-hmm.
have leadership planning and succession planning.
Mm-hmm.
We help to provide nonprofit management, so HR and financial guidance.
Mm-hmm.
So that's part of it, building the capacity of the organizations. But then they also have access to grants, to resources, to information.
Through you?
Through NCLR,
okay.
yes.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a variety of different program areas. We have staff, we have experts in different areas. And so one of the biggest benefits is that, you know, we're able to collectively speak on behalf of our affiliate network and be the voice of Latinos on the national scale. But at the same time, we try to establish a two-way dialogue so that we're
mm-hmm.
aware of what's happening at the local level through our affiliates,
right.
and we're able to respond to that. So if there is a need around immigration, right, and
right.
they want to know more about what's happening on the national level, then NCLR would step in and be able to provide that type of information and those resources
mm-hmm.
as needed. So,
wow. So, yeah, and I'm sure that's become far more important with these with DACA a couple years back, and now with this executive order. Can you tell me exactly how, or give me an example? You, I know that's not necessarily your area of work in NCLR, but how that might work. Let's say I'm part of a nonprofit, and I'm getting people from the community coming in and asking questions, and I'm not fully comfortable or ready to start addressing some of those changes in immigration. How might I seek and receive help from NCLR?
Yeah, that's a great question. NCLR is really at the front lines mm-hmm. of the immigration debate. One of the things that's really been our main focus mm-hmm. is ensuring that our affiliate organizations are receiving accurate and reliable information around immigration. And so part of our priorities are to make sure that we're sending that information to affiliates so that they can communicate that to their clients. Mm-hmm. And the idea is that we want to ensure that once implementation begins, so once the application process is out and folks are starting to sign up, they're educated on what the process is going to be like. They know whether or not they're eligible under DAPA or the expansion of DACA, mm-hmm. And if they're prepared. We want to mm-hmm. make sure they're prepared. So gathering their documentation and mm-hmm. Overall having the right information so that they can make the best decisions for themselves. And so that's our primary focus. Mm. But we're also doing work around sharing information on our website. Mm-hmm. We're part of the Committee for Immigration Reform Implementation. So we're working with national partners to participate in planning efforts so that these organizations have that internal capacity to mm-hmm. be able to provide legalization services. We're also sharing information via infographics, so mm-hmm. with basic information around immigration right. on Facebook and Twitter. And we've also developed an app.
An app?
Imigo, yes.
What's it called?
Imigo, Immigo. Mm-hmm. It's really a great tool. They can download it on iTunes and Google Play. But it's a great tool because you can check for legal service providers and you can stay updated on the recent announcements around immigration.
And this is for anyone?
For anyone. It's available mm-hmm. to download. We encourage everyone to use it. It's a great tool. It's something that you can pull up anywhere really and have access to that type of information. And then we're also, one of the, mm-hmm. the biggest things we're trying to do is to elevate the personal stories of folks that that mm-hmm. are benefiting from the administrative relief. So folks that that are contributing to our community and right. can demonstrate that it's a good thing for the country. So, you know, we have Enlace Chicago, which was on the show
right, right.
recently, and
yeah.
They're Katia one of our affiliates.
Yeah.
Yes,
mm-hmm. Katia,
she's great. They're one of our affiliates, and they just shared with us a story of Ana Velasquez. She's been in the Little Village community for over 20 years. Mm-hmm. She's been the pastor at her church for 20 years.
Wow.
She's the president of her child's school council, mm-hmm. And she's recently going to be joining the board of directors of Enlace Chicago. And so she's a great asset to our community, mm-hmm. and now thanks to relief, she's going to be able to apply.
She didn't have legal status. Doing all that work, was a resident and essentially a citizen of mm-hmm. our city, and didn't have...
No, but because mm-hmm. she has two U.S.-born children, mm-hmm. She's now going to be able to apply and begin to contribute. You know, I think she wants to pursue a career in mental health services for at-risk youth. You know, how much is that needed in our community?
Right,
and now
right,
she's
right.
finally going to have the chance to pursue it. So. It's a really great story. She's a prime example of who would be benefiting from this relief.
Wow, that's awesome. Mm-hmm. What are some of the other affiliates that you work with here in the city, and what other issues are they working on that you're helping support?
Yeah, so mm-hmm. so we have 19 organizations here in Chicago.
19, that's a pretty big number.
It is. It's mm-hmm. the largest concentration of affiliates in the Midwest region. And they're actually some of our strongest groups. You know, they've been around for a long time. We have a long history of community organizing mm-hmm. and service here in Chicago. And we see that through our affiliates. The Resurrection Project has also been actively okay. engaged in the immigration process.
Mm-hmm.
They're known more for a housing organization.
Right.
They recently built La Casa Student Housing Center
in
Pilsen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it's a first of its kind. They have senior housing. But I know that they've been really engaged in the immigration efforts and to educate our community.
Mm-hmm.
They've passed out over 20,000 flyers mm-hmm. with information around the relief efforts, and
mm-hmm.
You know, they're great. We have organizations like El Hogar del Niño and Gads Hill Center, mm-hmm. I think, who have also been
they've been guests here.
Yes, they
you're
do
among
a lot
friends.
Of work.
You're among friends.
Yeah, yeah, which is great.
Yeah.
I love to hear that.
Mm-hmm.
So they do a lot of work around early childhood education. Mm-hmm. We have organizations that focus on housing, on mm-hmm. foreclosure prevention, job training programs. Mm-hmm. So it's really a wide variety of organizations, Instituto del Progreso Latino on Blue Island and Western. Right. They've been providing job training programs for a long time, and mm-hmm. we actually started a joint venture with them about 4 or 5 years ago now, called Carreras en Salud. Mm-hmm. And it was a program to provide the mm-hmm. skills, both ESL classes, but then also specifically for the health field around mm-hmm. Jobs mm-hmm. for the long term. So that was a really great partnership that we did with them.
Tell me a little more about that program, just for our viewers, because you just touched on it a little bit. What is it exactly for again?
Mm-hmm. So Carreras en Salud mm-hmm. Is a partnership between NCLR, mm-hmm. Instituto del Progreso Latino, Humboldt Park Social Services, and Association House. And what they do is they help to provide community members that are interested in a career in the health field with the skills necessary. So it begins with ESL classes, just so English.
Mm-hmm. English doesn't have to be the first language then.
No, English does mm-hmm. not. That's actually the community that they target. Mm-hmm. So those that do not have English proficiency but are learning English skill, the English language, mm-hmm. they're also pursuing classes at the community college around CNA programs, or mm-hmm. Which are certified nurse assistants, or LPNs, licensed practicing nurses, mm-hmm. And eventually possibly even to be a registered nurse. So it's a program that really combines the skills and the resources of different organizations mm-hmm. to pursue for community members to pursue long-term career growth.
Wow, that's awesome. You named a few of them. That was like 4 or 5 you named. What are some of the other organizations that you work with here in the city? And then I do want to talk about other work you're doing in the Midwest, because I'm sure, though there are similarities, there are some issues that other communities around this region face that we don't necessarily face mm-hmm. here.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So other groups here in Chicago mm-hmm. Include Erie Neighborhood House.
Okay.
They've
been around for some time, right?
Yes, they've been around for over 100 years. They're in the Ukrainian Village community, or mm-hmm. Westtown. Mm-hmm. They have been helping in a variety of different ways. They have after-school programs. They also have job training programs. Mm-hmm. And they've also been very involved in the immigration efforts. Mm-hmm. We have the Spanish Coalition for Housing. It's located on the northwest side of the city. They focus on housing services.
Right. Mm-hmm.
They recently hosted Senator Durbin and Lisa Madigan for a press conference to show the effects of their housing services in the community. Mm. We also have Brighton Park Neighborhood Council on the southwest side of the city.
Yeah.
And they also provide similar programs around housing. And they also work with community schools for after school programs.
Yeah, it's a wide list of services and different areas you're working in.
Yes.
And what about, tell me about a couple of organizations in some other cities in the Midwest that you work with?
Yeah. So, I mean, our Midwest region is really diverse. We have organizations in Michigan.
Yeah, people don't tend to think of the Midwest as diverse. They tend to think Midwest is boring, bland, flat.
I disagree.
So do I. But I think that's the perception a lot of people outside of the Midwest have.
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's true. Mm-hmm. And, you know, as Latino serving organizations, mm-hmm. You know, and being from Chicago and having such a strong group of organizations here, mm-hmm. and luckily, you know, we have more of a progressive city government. And, you know, when we go to places like Minnesota or Nebraska or Ohio, which are all part of the Midwest region, their issues are a little different. And, you know, the community dynamics are a little different. But at the same mm-hmm. time, it's still a Latino community, and they're still mm-hmm. facing some of the same issues that we face here, mm-hmm. you know. quality education, lack of different resources, financial instability, jobs. Mm-hmm. So there are. It's a different community, but there's similarities across the needs mm-hmm. of those groups.
Mm-hmm. And what do you see happening? What would you hope for? I know you can't speak for the organization itself, but what would you hope for here in Chicago and in the Midwest as far as NCLR's work? How would you like to see it grow or expand or connect?
Yeah. So. You know, NCLR has really focused a lot of our efforts in prioritizing the needs of our affiliates.
Mm-hmm.
So again, everything that NCLR mm-hmm. does is based on the work that we're doing with our affiliates. Here in the Midwest, we've really taken, we have regional meetings so every fall we bring together all of our groups from the region and we come together and we talk about some of the issues, right? And we discuss ways that we can share information amongst the groups. So one of the things that I think I would like to see here in the Midwest is to continue to grow that. It's really the only opportunity, it's the only platform that Latino serving organizations have that to come together and to talk with one another. You know, if I have a program around after school funding or after school programs and there's another organization that runs a similar program and that can give me their best practices or some of the lessons learned, and I can go and apply that back at my organization. That's really a great tool, and it's something that is one of the biggest benefits of being an NCLR affiliate is that there's a network of folks.
And I think what you're saying is it's collaboration instead of competition, right? Because I think sometimes nonprofits are, well, at least locally, I've seen they compete sometimes for monies or for things, and unfortunately, but you're cultivating this, you're nurturing collaboration.
Definitely a collaboration. It probably helps that we are bringing in folks from different states and different areas. But you know, even here in Chicago, we see that collaboration amongst groups and sharing of resources. You know, if one organization is an expert on one topic and the other on the other, then maybe there's a partnership there. And it's not necessarily competing, but it's collaboration amongst resources.
Now, I do want to talk about, like, what if somebody, because the work of NCLR obviously attracted you and in some way inspired you to join them. What if somebody wanted to volunteer like your annual conference or at some other regional conference or whatever another activity you might be hosting? How would somebody here in Chicago go about doing that?
Yes, so we're based in Washington, D.C. So our volunteer efforts revolve around our major events, like our annual conference. So for folks here or across the country, we would encourage them to reach out to our D.C. headquarters, but because our annual conference actually travels each year. And so last year we were in Los Angeles. This year we're going to be in Kansas City on July 11th through the 14th. So if anyone's interested in joining us in Kansas City, we encourage them to do so. By being a volunteer, you know, they go for free. They can take part in workshops and town halls and different events that we have during the conference. So we would definitely encourage them to reach out to our Washington, D.C. office or visit our website and get more information there. We'd be happy to have them.
Oh, that's awesome. And if somebody wanted to, like, present a workshop or something, do they have to be part of an affiliate in order to do that?
No, they don't have to be part of the affiliate network to present a workshop. We do have a workshop application process. It should be on our website in mid-February, I believe. But they would have to apply and go through the process. We do prioritize our affiliates. However, it doesn't completely disregard their application.
Okay, we're getting close to the end of the show. Just give me a brief rundown of what, because I've heard of the NCLR conference and how great it is. It's so informative. It's, I think, a very re-energizing event that a lot of friends who have gone to it have spoken about. What's it like for our viewers, and what kind of workshops might we attend if we do go?
Yeah, so it's really a great event. We have 60 plus workshops throughout the 4 days. So conference runs from Saturday to Tuesday. We have a variety of different issues. All the issues that NCLR works with, if you're interested in learning more about different trends in education and so what is the work that our charter schools are doing, or the Gates Foundation might be there and present on a workshop. From that to housing to health, and we've had workshops around ACA enrollment. You know, the deadline's coming up on February 15th.
Right,
we want to make sure that folks are getting covered. To youth development, youth after school workshops. We have a Líderes Summit that primarily focuses on youth from 14 to 22. We also have a variety of workshops. We also have town halls where we invite leaders from different communities. We have we've had really prominent speakers at some of our luncheons. You know, President Obama was there a couple years ago. We've had Vice President Joe Biden. So we've had a number of great speakers also take part in the luncheons. And it's really a great event. And I think the biggest takeaway is that you get to meet so many people in your field or in different fields, but that in fields that you're interested in. Right. And it's really a great opportunity to network with one another and to connect. And then we also have a huge family expo that's kind of, it runs concurrent with our workshops. And we have a variety of partners there, our corporate partners, and we have different events going on there, and we encourage folks from the community, so hopefully from Kansas City and anyone who joins us there, to come out and take part in that.
Wow, that's so awesome, and hopefully I'll get to make it to one of them.
Hopefully, yeah.
Well, thanks so much for coming out today. It was great to hear from you, and well, good luck with all your work.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
And to you, thank you for joining us. Perspectivas Latinas is a community service of CAN TV. If your nonprofit organization would like to work with CAN TV, call 312-738-1400 and ask for nonprofit services. Tune in to Perspectivas Latinas for local issues and concerns every Thursday at 8:30 p.m. on CAN TV 21. I'm Juan Carlos Hernandez. Thank you for joining us.